السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته everybody. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, and may Allah's peace and blessings be upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. It's a great pleasure to see everybody, be with everybody, I guess that's being more correct. Again, I just arrived from Lumita. I was at your masjid only a couple of hours ago to give the two khutbas there, and I was very, very, very excited to see so many people I haven't seen for a while. So alhamdulillah, it always brings me a lot of joy and pleasure to see our community members, alhamdulillah. So may Allah continue to bless the community and bless the masjid, bless Sheikh Anas, his family, of course. And inshallah, may we be reunited again when the masjid is fully functional with COVID-19 over, inshallah. So the topic of today is kind of an interesting one, is basically how to vote our conscience, how to vote morally, basically. I always hear from people, and it's probably a very important season, because unlike in the past, usually there's an election day, right? And you get the mailer. From most people vote in person, and most people wait for election day. This election is going to be a little bit different this year, because everyone is going to get basically a mail-in or a mailed ballot. Everyone will get to vote by mail. There are still ways you can do voting in person, by the way. There are voting centers that will open a few days before election, before the last election day. We can talk about that later on. But I just want to make sure that COVID-19 should not be an excuse for us not to vote, not to be engaged. If anything, is probably a good reminder that it's actually more so and more important for us to vote, as we see how the economy might be happening, what direction it might take because of COVID-19, because of the lack of leadership, whether it's a state level or federal level or local level, wherever you might think. I personally think we're doing okay statewide, but still a lot of challenges. So without getting into all of that, and we'll talk about it a little bit, this is an important election. We have many choices. We have issues dealing with, obviously, growing Islamophobia, growing anti-Black racism, xenophobia, anti-immigrant sentiment, the economy. We have issues dealing with foreign issues, what Israel has been doing. We have a president who decided to move our embassy to occupy Jerusalem, therefore legitimizing occupation. We have what is happening in East Turkestan and China to the Uyghur brothers and sisters. And we as a superpower have been making some lip service comments about the issue, but really not much. What's happening in Kashmir, in Syria, and many, many other places, of course, that we'll talk about. But the key thing is, this is an election that will impact all of these issues in one way or the other. So you can't say, I want to be neutral. But also, any good person, any person of conscience, would worry about, like, what if I vote? What if my vote ends up making things worse? That's a legitimate concern. So how do we deal with that? First of all, I want to maybe remove the misunderstanding of the or misperception that political engagement is voting. Voting is only one of the tools, and actually, it's almost like the last item on the list in a way. If your political engagement is about voting, you've missed what political engagement is all about. Political engagement is about getting to know the issues, caring about the issues, advocating for those issues, mobilizing, energizing regarding these issues, building coalitions, meeting with elected officials, maybe running for office, maybe volunteering on a campaign, maybe raising money for a campaign, following up on this issue again and again. And then on the day of election, you vote. So don't just wait and don't sleep for the whole year or 2 years or 4 years, depending which of the elections talking about you're dealing with. But don't be asleep all this time, and then on election day or season say, oh, I'm not sure who to vote for. Then you know, and then complain that, hey, these politicians are not paying attention to us. Of course, if we were missing an action throughout the year or the last 2 or 4 years, you know, why would they care? If I didn't care about these issues, why should somebody who might not be as connected as me about these issues care? So that is important. So it's not just about voting. It's about everything else that comes before the voting happens. Also, keeping in mind that voting is a way, it's almost like a popularity issue. You know, you're telling them what issues are important to be popular or priority for this candidate or this elected official when they win. If they know that for us, social economics issues, economic justice issues, human rights issues, anti-racism issues, if they know that there's a block of voters in their district, in their city, in their state, depending, again, what we're talking about, care about this issue and can bring in enough votes to make somebody win or lose, take my word, they will pay attention. You know that. They're going to pay attention and they're going to say, this is an issue I cannot ignore. And not only before the vote, after they make it to the office, they are going to make that a priority because they know if they don't respond to your needs. And again, we're not asking for something illegal, immoral. We're asking for moral things. It's just about shifting priorities for them. What makes it on the list of priorities depends on what is a priority for a large number of voters in the district of these candidates or elected officials. That's what it is. That's as simple. Do you think members of Congress care about all the issues the same way? No. Their level, their personal interest might be one or two. You know, there might be the environment, might be fighting racism, etc. And then the rest of the issues they work on, the dozens and dozens and dozens of other issues, are determined by how committed the voters and how large that number of voters are about this issue. So this is what it is. We create the peer pressure. We create the public opinion. We create the interest, whatever that is. Think about it. And our issues, alhamdulillah, are issues that impact other people. We're not selfish people. You know, yeah, we might talk about ending the Muslim ban, but even this issue, it's, you know, the Muslim ban deals with xenophobia, anti-immigrant sentiment, racism, bigotry. So when we can solve this problem, we're helping other people. So that's why when we can build coalitions, we can work with others to make this difference happen. So quick thing to clarify, you know, as all of you hopefully know, I've been regular with you, so I don't say that humbly. I'm your brother, Hisham Ayloush. I'm with CARE, the Council on American Islamic Relations. CARE is a nonprofit organization, so we cannot endorse specific candidates. We can endorse propositions as any nonprofit, but we cannot endorse candidates against the law. Not that I don't want to do that, but you cannot do as a masjid. You cannot do that either. But we can talk about the issues, and you can use your conscience, you can use your logic to find out who is closer and who connects to these issues. Now, a few things to mention. And I'm going to mention that because every time I talk about elections or political involvement within the community, I hear from people say, well, I'm fed up and sick and tired of our system. You know, is bad person or worse person? I don't like the two-party system. I wish we had a third party or fourth party and so on. This is what we have. I agree. I think it's a weakness in our political system that we only have two. Because what happens, most people are not black or white, right? Most people are, you know, nuanced. Most people, and I'm not talking about race here, right? I'm talking about political views, ideological views. Most people are not either left or right. A lot of people are everywhere on that spectrum. You know, centrist on issues, maybe left on these issues, environmentalist, socially responsive, socially conservative, socially. I mean, basically, there are a lot of things that two parties cannot encompass fully. But that's what we have. I would like for you and me to work very hard throughout the, you know, after election to focus on maybe helping others establish and maybe call for the establishment for other parties. And the system doesn't stop it, by the way, or at least the law doesn't. It is just that people are very comfortable where they're at. And the two political or the two main political parties have so much influence that they made it almost impossible for the other smaller parties that exist. They do exist, but they don't get the access that make them viable or make them able to bring about viable candidates. So it makes no sense to sit here and now you know, cry over spilled milk and say, well, you know, we don't have that. That's what we have now. You know, they say you don't play with the cards you wish you have. You play with the cards that you have. Halal playing, right? Nothing, no gambling. So basically what it is, what we have is that flawed system. Let's work to get the best out of it. That's what it is. We do have a flawed system that actually favors candidates from these two parties that exist. Media only recognizes these people. We have media that is influenced by those who fund it. We have people who take being a politician as a career, which means they'll do anything to stay in power. So they're no longer there to serve a cause and move. Many end up making that as a career. And sometimes that means compromising on the issues in order to stay in power. So there's fear, there's politics of fear. These are all flaws that are built in the system. But I have to say, as someone who has, you know, a hobby of monitoring and viewing political systems in the world, this is also one of the best. You know, one of the top five political systems that exist that allows for stability, that allows for engagement. And it's as good as we participate in it. Again, with all its flaws. Don't think I'm not into American exceptionalism. You know, we have a lot of flaws that need to be fixed within the system itself. However, it's a great system that it can actually get really good if we participate, if we as citizens participate in it. So political engagement is one way to ensure that the system does not become exploited to serve a certain class of people at the expense of everybody else, in addition to actually minimizing harm, advancing goodness, building coalitions. When you go and pay taxes, and you've heard that a million times, when you go and even when you fill up gas, right, you pay taxes. There's a county tax, there's a state tax, federal tax. Where do you think those tax dollars go to? They go basically to the treasury, state, local, federal, and then who decides how this tax money is spent? Politicians that you elected or did not elect. So whether you chose to elect them or not, you're basically, if you don't vote and engage politically, you're telling them, I trust you blindly, take my money and spend it the way you want. That's what it is. So there's no one who is not politically engaged. It is only a question is, am I engaged actively or passively? If I don't vote and I don't engage actively, that means I'm telling them take my money. So that means I'm passively engaged. No, what we're asking you to do is do, you know, proactive engagement. So you have a say in how your money is spent. Is it for better jobs? Is it to fight poverty? Is it to help those who are in need? Is it to advance, you know, our country technologically? Is it to help medical inventions and research to help and better people's life? Is it about promoting human rights in America and abroad? Or is it about the other way around, promoting warfare, racism, bigotry, et cetera, et cetera? So it is in our hands. So this is what it is. Now, what I've been hearing from the community is, I heard it today, actually. I was talking to somebody after Jum'ah. A dear brother came to me, and I heard that last week, and I hear that almost every day on social media. People who say, I'm no longer excited about the election. I was initially, but then my favorite candidate didn't win. Presidential, Congress, you know, there when we had the primaries. And my question to them is like, what, you're going to retire now because your candidate didn't win? You know, we can't do that. This was never, and elections are rarely, by the way, elections are rarely about choosing between good and bad, rare. I've been doing this for over 30 years in America. I can count on a single hand, the number of times when the choice was between good and bad, where we had an actually good candidate and really bad options and candidates. Most times it is not. Most times it is between various candidates. Some are better on certain issues, others are better on the other issues, and eventually some are really bad on issues and the other ones are less bad on the issues. So really what it is, it's really an ijtihad, really like a judgment call on finding and assessing who can bring less harm and who can bring more goodness to mankind, to your community, to society, and so on. really, as sometimes people refer to it, as choosing the lesser of two evils, right? I don't like to do that all the time because people, you know, I don't want a candidate to think, just to hear that we're calling them evil. You know, some, maybe their actions could be evil. But to put it in Islamic terms, you know, the Islamic term does not use lesser of two evils. It uses jalbul masa, or you said in the fiqh, they call it daf'ul mafasid or daf'ul mafsada wa jalbul maslaha, basically, you know, pushing away harm and bringing good. This is really any decision outside of praying, outside of fasting, outside of set worship rituals, it's about masalih. It's about maslaha, which is common good. And how do you assess maslaha or common good is really about pushing harm, pushing away harm. Somebody who's, if they win, they're going to be bringing in racism, hate, warfare, etc. So you want to push as much of that away and bringing maslaha, good, goodness, interest. And that is somebody who, if they come in, they're going to, you know, they're going to be against racism. Somebody who's going to push for affirmative action. Somebody who's going to help businesses or help provide less, maybe better educations and less fees, college and education fees and so on. So this is really what it is about voting. Think about it. It's really about finding the bill, the proposition, the legislation, the candidate who will bring more good, or actually the first one is actually who will push more harm, because our scholars have said all the time, daf'ul mafasid, the pushing of mafasid, you know, the pushing of harm is preferred over bringing goodness. Meaning if you have a choice between that, pushing harm is more important at this point. Being without harm is more important because that is what's hurting people. So that is really what we're doing. A lot of people are hurting. There are a lot of people who are struggling in our country and abroad because of these politicians. So know that your decision helps. It's an act of ibadah, as our scholars have said, because we are ordered in Islam as Muslims. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the ummah, when he said, "Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas," you are the best of nations sent for mankind. Why? You enjoin the good and you forbid the evil and you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you hear me say that a lot because that's what makes us unique. That's what makes us Muslims, really. Enjoin good, forbid the evil, and believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, we're just activists. We're just, and there's nothing wrong with that. But I want to be more than just an activist. I do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I do it because you do it. You vote. When you go, it's an act of ibadah, act of worship. You're doing it because that's what you want to do. You're enjoining good, you're forbidding evil, and you're doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking His pleasure. So for us, it is that act of ibadah we want to do. We can't sit down. The other point I want to also, and I know I'm throwing a lot of points for you, but I want you to keep, put that in mind because I don't want you to be hesitating and miss out. We have way too many important things for us to sit idle and sit on the sideline and let others decide our fate and the fate of 330 million people in America and billions of people, at least impact the lives of billions of people around the world. Yeah, what happens in America and in the White House and in Congress not only impacts you and me, but it impacts people all over the world, in Afghanistan, in Syria, in Egypt, in Iran, in Turkey, in Kashmir, in India, in Pakistan, in East Turkestan, in China, in Europe, in Africa, in Sudan, we're witnessing what's happening, in Palestine. I mean, the list goes on and on. This is impacted. So you and I already have some responsibility. So let's make it a positive responsibility, not just a neutral, passive one. So what I wanted to say also is that when we think of election, I know many of us think presidential. And they say, well, I'm not sure who to vote for. You know what? I'm not sure who is the lesser of two evils, right? Who brings it? You know, they say, I'm debating. I personally think, I know, again, there is no good candidate versus bad, right? We're looking at, I feel, I know who can bring, push away more harm and bring in more good. You might disagree with me, and that is okay. And I'm not going to tell you who it is. I said, remember, we're 501c3. But I want you to think about it this way. And I'm not saying don't vote for presidential election, but if you are one of these people, after making a lot of dua and istikhara and asking your friends and reading a lot, and you're still not convinced one of the two candidates that we have now, Trump or Biden, pushes more harm and brings more good, if after all of that you're still not, I'll tell you don't worry about it. Abstain. You're not going to make a difference anyway. California is kind of a blue state. The presidential a winner is almost determined now, predetermined. And I'm not recommending that, but I'm saying if that is your conclusion, that's fine. Don't ignore the other races and the other propositions. You know, who's going to vote for your member of Congress? Who's going to vote for the state assembly, state senate, your mayor, city council people? All of these people, by the way, have probably more impact on you than the presidential winner. All of these people, because these are at a state level, at a local level, these are the people who impact your local taxes, your education, safety, police, how much police money, how much money is put in police or in community development. Who is holding the police accountable when they violate the law and abuse power? Who is, how are your public school system, funding? Who are the teachers? Do they have a program against school bullying? Do they promote racism or not? What kind of curriculum? You're talking about your state jobs, our jobs in the state, our economy. You're talking about so many things that are impacted. And guess what? I'll tell you something you might think that's bad news, but that's the reality. Whoever wins in the upcoming election, we're still going to have a lot of challenges. The mess that exists in our country today is so deeply rooted, it's going to take a while to undo. And also considering probably the state will be still run by a majority that is not very friendly to our issues, not a lot of federal level change is going to happen for laws in a way. If Trump wins, we're going to have four more years of maybe pushing the same policies we've seen, the Muslim ban, the marginalization of minorities, the creating the tension that exists. If Trump loses, I can tell you some people are saying some of his crazy followers might get on the street, pick up arms or blame minorities. And guess who among them would be on top of the list? Muslims, blacks, Latinos. These are the groups that are going to be targeted. Say, you made our president lose. So either way, so don't worry about that. Worry about how to strengthen our base, our allies, our partners. How can we make sure we have as many friends at a city council level, county level supervisors, at a state level? So if things go bad, our attorney general. So if things go bad at a national level, we have all these layers to kind of protect our rights, protect the country from going anywhere crazy and so on. So we have even more so of a must to do that as a community. Very few points again, and I'm throwing a lot of points, and I will stop very soon so we can have a discussion, maybe Q&A. I want to say something from an American privilege perspective. Yes, each one of you, my dear brothers and sisters, including me, we are privileged. We are extremely privileged. We live in a free country. Again, with all the flaws, and again, believe me, I'm at the forefront of fighting against the abuses that exist. But I'm also fair enough, and I know you're fair enough, to recognize that we are privileged from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be able to have that opportunity to vote, to dissent, to sue our government, to complain vocally, to talk about it in our khutbas, to talk about it in our class, without fearing that if I were in any of the Arab countries, I can speak about Middle Eastern countries now, let's talk about Arab countries, Iran, maybe, that's where I'm familiar, but probably it's the same in some other countries outside of those. If we're having that session where we're talking about with a critical way about government and government officials, chances are all of us will be arrested, and that will be the last program we'll ever participate in before our execution. May Allah protect us all. But alhamdulillah, we have a constitution that protects our right, and we want to ensure that continues. But what I meant is, because of that privilege, this adds a responsibility on our shoulder. You know, our brothers and sisters in all the countries that I've mentioned, all probably the entire Arab world, maybe with the exception of Tunisia and maybe Lebanon, but all the Arab countries, you know, imagine people in Yemen, imagine people in Egypt, people in Iran, imagine people in East Turkestan under China's control, in Burma, the Muslims who actually mostly are refugees now, those who survived, people in Kashmir, imagine what they're doing. They are risking their lives almost every day to have that privilege that we take for granted, that privilege of choosing your leaders, and not only choosing them, but holding them accountable, subhanAllah, and having the ability to dissent with them and criticize them and campaign against them and push your issues and lobby for your issues. These are privileges people are literally risking and losing their lives to achieve and attain. Alhamdulillah, we have it on a silver platter. And I don't say that because it came, you know, on its own, you know, because others have done that many generations before in America, especially the people of color and specifically our African-American brothers and sisters, not only risked their lives, but gave their lives so you and I can have that privilege today as a minority, today, as a religious minority in America or an ethnic minority. So alhamdulillah, we have it. Others sacrifice so we can enjoy. The least we can do is exercise it in order to protect it and in order to basically advance goodness for all other people. So I will conclude by urging myself, urging my dear brothers and sisters to energize ourselves, our friends, make a plan, you know, because starting next week, and some of you already have, should have received your ballot now, the mailing ballots, and you can start mailing them starting tomorrow. You have all this time to mail the ballots now. You have all the time, you can start mailing it, and it has to be postmarked by the election day, right? Which is November 2nd, I think Tuesday, yes. So until election day, let me double check, it is November 2nd, not 3rd, the Tuesday, what it is, November 3rd. So Tuesday, all I knew is the first Tuesday. So by November 3rd, it has to be postmarked. You can start mailing it as soon as you receive it. By November 3rd, if it's postmarked, even if it takes up to 17 days after you've mailed it, if they receive it, if there's slow mail on that day, that's fine. As long as they receive it after 17 days, it will count. Everybody can vote by mail. If you wish to vote in person, there are something called vote centers throughout various counties, including LA County. So you can go online. Actually, there's a good website that I would suggest you take. It's called vote.ca.gov, like government, right? vote.ca.gov. If you click on it, you can find out if you're registered to vote or not. If you're not, you can register to vote on the spot there. They can tell you exactly how you can vote in person, how you can do it in mail, how you can do it by mail, and so on and so forth. Of course, to vote in person, it will start only on October 24th. On Saturday, October 24th is when you can start. Actually, all voting centers will be available October 30th, but few would be available, including in your county, on October 24th for you to vote. So with that said, I just want to conclude by saying that there is no reason for us not to, alhamdulillah. Everything is available for us to do to help us vote. And have a plan, organize your family, make sure they know, consult. CARE will be issuing a voter guide actually next week. You should be receiving the information online, on WhatsApp, on the website of CARE, CARE California website, ca.care.com, ca.care.com. You can visit that, and I'll put it in the chat also. I hope somebody is putting some of the info that I mentioned. Let me actually put that, the one I said, there's the voter. I'll put it in so everybody can benefit from it. So there's voter.ca.gov. So that's a website that, didn't type it. voter.ca.gov. Okay, that should work. Oh, it did work. And there is the CARE website, also for all the voter information that CARE will be providing, the voter guide. Basically, what the voter guide does is it will give you our recommendations for the propositions. There are a couple of important ones. So again, these are our suggestions. You might disagree, alhamdulillah, it's okay. But, you know, we did the research. We thought one way is better than the other, but you might have your own opinion. Alhamdulillah, nothing wrong with that. And we have some scoring of how your elected officials, basically everywhere in the state, have voted on certain issues. We're talking about federal level, members of Congress and U.S. senators, and state level, state assembly members and state senators. How we voted on bills and legislation that are important to our community, immigration, civil rights, human rights, and so on. So with that, I want to conclude now, because I want to give ourselves 10-15 minutes, inshallah, of Q&A or maybe comments to hear from you. I see a lot of familiar names. I'm so happy to read your names. Some of you I get to see at the masjid today. Others I haven't seen for a while. So I got a glimpse of Dr. Rashagi early on. I was happy to see him. I saw him a couple of weeks ago at another event, but alhamdulillah, the rest I see. Assalamu alaikum to everybody.
JazakAllah khairan, brother Ayloush, for taking your time to educate everyone on how to vote and why it's important. Really appreciate it. So with this, guys, we'll begin the Q&A.
So I have some questions.
Okay, go ahead, brother, go ahead.
Brother Ayloush, thank you very much for taking the time and educating the community. I have a question. I mean, based on whatever survey that has been done, including the census and all that, do we really know how many voting Muslim people are in the United States? Do we have any, I mean, an estimate?
No real estimates. Unfortunately, we don't have good estimates of our population in general. That's the problem. Because even the census, which is not over yet, alhamdulillah, does not, because census does not track people by religion.
Right.
Tracks them by ethnic background or origin. So we have, I mean, we have done some studies, some even more serious academic organization have done some studies. They've estimated the number of Muslims in America to be around, maybe around, they say about 4 million, maybe 4 to 5 million. We think there's about a million Muslims in California. Again, estimate how many of them are under 18, how many are eligible to vote, how many have registered to vote. It's hard to tell. I would say maybe someone said a million. I would say that sounds like a good number. I think there's a million, 1.3 million maybe voters around the country.
Well, thank you.
We have a question from Brother Nuri.
Okay. Yes. Assalamu alaikum, Brother Hisham.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Jazakallah khairan for this lecture, for the info. Brother, my question, brother, is regarding the mailing ballots. You hear about the fraud and what's going on. How can I guarantee that my ballot gets there, counted, and worked on?
Absolutely. If you visit the link that I provided, they have they give you ideas. You know, including there's a tracking number. There's something. Yes. There's a system. You can.
Well, I received this today.
Ah, excellent.
Yeah.
So the tracking number will allow you to track, making sure your ballot made it there. There's also, they're talking about the link that I sent you. They're talking about maybe taking a video, a short video, yes, of your vote. So there are a lot of steps. I mean, if you go visit the website, actually, it's very interesting. It's a state website, so it's not a care website. Mm-hmm. It gives a lot of ideas. I mean, honestly, let me be very blunt. Mm. There's nothing guaranteed, right? That could happen anytime. However, the fear-mongering or the care tactics are being used mostly by the Trump administration.
Yeah.
Almost to discourage people from, again, I don't want to get partisan here, but this is a fact. They're the ones who keep raising the issue of, fraud, not fraud. Basically, what is the option? Not to vote? Alhamdulillah, I think we have a system that's going to be, I want to say 95-99% proof, of any abuse or fraud.
Yes.
There's no perfect system. The only perfect system is Allah's system. It's a human, what we're doing here is human, but that's not an excuse not to vote. I think it's a pretty safe one, and we should go ahead and vote.
All right. JazakAllah. Okay.
We have one more question from the chat, and I just want to ask that. Someone was asking, for those who find it inconceivable to choose either of the presidential candidates, what is their opinion to still engage this election in a meaningful manner? Can they vote in other things except pick any of the presidential candidates?
Yeah. So, as I said, maybe that's Brother Nuruddin, excellent question. I actually did refer to that point, but I'll repeat it again because it's an important question. I said, if after everything you've read and investigated and consulted and talked to people who love Trump and swear, he's the best thing ever, and talk to people who love Biden and swear he's the best thing ever, and after hearing all of that, if you still don't think that one of the two candidates will cause less harm and bring more good, abstain. don't vote on this category, the presidential. You know, you can say I vote for Mickey Mouse, right? Or put my name, Hisham Ayloush. I'm not running for president, but you know, whatever it is, put your protest vote. But what matters is you still have dozens of other areas where to vote. You're talking about the ballots, you're talking about your own assembly, your own city council, your own. So these things, you can't tell me, and I know you, Brother Nuruddin, you're not the one saying that, but I mean, if somebody tells you that, tell them, you can't tell me that none of these issues, you found a way, you know, way that is leaning more good than bad. I mean, it can't be. There's not, it's impossible. So there must be something where your heart leans toward because you feel this would help more people than, you know, voting yes on this proposition would help more than voting no or neutral, for example. So yes, I hope that answers the question, Brother Nuruddin. Any other question?
I had a question. So if you think about the power that corporations and lobbyists and all these other players outside of voting hold, compared to the average voter, like how significant, or like how impactful would your individual vote be when there's like huge corporations that literally have congressmen and politicians in their pockets?
Yes, excellent question. This is part of the first element or factor that I raised, right? I talked about we have a flawed system. So I'm not going to debate you. I agree with you. I'm actually as angry as you might be about the flaw in the system that gives corporations and big money a lot of say in our election system or our political system as a whole. But I would say it happens for two reasons. One is because good people have become so disenfranchised that it, you know, it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, right? Because I initially people say, well, you know, how can I trust the system? It's flawed. And then they started, you know, marginalizing themselves. When you and I leave, we create a vacuum. There's no such thing as a vacuum. Something has to fill that vacuum. Who filled that vacuum? More corrupt people, more people who are accountable only to their funders, you know, the businesses, the big businesses, big money. So eventually we're creating, you know, a vicious cycle. More good people pull out, more bad lobbyists get in. So the only way we can counter that is because the system in general was supposed to be more biased towards the people, you know, the little man, right? The average man, average person. But by when the average person, average citizen is out, it, you know, the corrupt came in. So no, we can come back. And I will say big money has a lot of influence in big races, big important races, you know, sometimes federal level, you know, Congress, U.S. Senate, presidential, but they're not that involved on the local level. City council, school boards, of course, they try to come in and they put money in, but because the number of vote is not that huge, sometimes how 100 people vote in a city council race can determine the race. I can tell you, if the Muslim voters who go to Lomita Masjid decide on one candidate among themselves, they can sway an election, literally. Basically, there could be 2-3 candidates running for the same seat or same district. The one who's going to win is the one who's going to get maybe 300-400 votes difference. Sometimes 5 votes, sometimes 1 vote. I've seen it. I've seen a lot of these that I can say it's normal, not an exception, where it's a really small number. I can tell you, if you and your families and friends vote one way for a candidate rather than the other way, you can make a city council member win or lose, regardless what a company or corporation had in mind. You know, there might be big businesses and corporations in the city who wanted to have X instead of Y, but they can buy votes. What they can do is give money to buy visibility. So that person will have more visibility. Visibility is not enough. Visibility does not counter number of votes. So that's something they can't, because corporations cannot vote themselves. So what I'm saying is, yes, it is there, but how do we counter that? By being even more organized, more informed. We have social media. Social media is a double-edged sword. You know, what happens is every election, we know there's something called the October surprise. What it is something is presented to sway voters one way or the other. Usually one side pushes it. You know, we've seen, usually it has been targeting Muslims, creating fear. Social media has allowed it. Last election, we had Russia and its intelligence and its agents putting tens of millions of dollars on social media ads to create fear of Muslims, basically associating Hillary Clinton with radical Islam and the Muslim Brotherhood and the, whatever it is you can imagine, creating fear among enough people who ended up going to vote for Trump. So it has an impact. This is not something we talk about. So me, what I'm saying is, social media can be also the other way around. Each one of you has an account on social media, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, you name it. If you start promoting truth about this candidate or that candidate, exposing bias, standing for your values, say, hey, we need to vote for somebody who is clearly against racism, someone who does not hesitate to condemn white supremacy, someone who's not gonna wage war against this country or that country. And by the way, I don't want people to think I'm promoting Biden versus Trump. I mean, as I said, I'm not going to share my personal choice, but Biden can be criticized for a lot of things too. Biden has talked about undermining the democracy in Turkey, one of the few democracies in the region, for example. Like, so Biden is so close to the AIPAC circles, you know, Trump is too. But what I'm saying is, use social media to educate people and mobilize people, because that counters what corporations can spend to promote.
Thank you, brother.
I have one more question, brother Ayloush. So you've been active, God knows, for maybe last 35, 40 years in this organization, and you have seen the evolution of the younger people, you know, stepping to the next level and becoming active. And you have seen now, alhamdulillah, we have some Congress people. Has CARE done a study to see how the trend is and, I mean, how the progress is? I mean, how do you look at the future in terms of more and more younger people in the Muslim community? I know they are pursuing degrees in laws and degrees in sociology, degrees that are not the traditional engineering and medicine, somehow, or political science. They want to, how do you see that? How do you see that trend evolving, and how can you make a prediction for the next? I mean, somebody like you should be able to do that.
Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with engineers. We love petrol. We love
petrol. I know you're an engineer, right?
and we love aerospace engineers too. Alhamdulillah. But you're right. I've seen a trend. I can tell you there are studies done. A great organization to look into is ISPU, the Institute of Social Policy. I forget the it's ISPU, you know, Sister Dr. Dalia Mugad. I forget the U stands for what? Understanding, maybe. They do a lot of studies. They do a lot of surveys, and they keep monitoring trends on long-term benefits. So, alhamdulillah, it's a good organization. Check their website. They actually just released another survey today, the results of another survey tracking Muslim voters and how many are interested or leaning either way. But let me tell you from what I've seen, you know, scientifically or maybe some guesstimates. The trend is good. American Muslims are certainly shifting into the mainstream, shifting into carrying issues that are beyond their personal ones, and nothing wrong with carrying some personal ones too. They're becoming more connected with other communities. They are running for office. They are getting into fields of studies that allow them into understanding social science, you know, again, political science, law, etc. You know, these are the fields that usually people end up using to become more politically active. Muslims are running for office. We have dozens of them running you know, actually almost 100 that we know of nationwide, including a dozen or so in our own communities. Dr. Faisal Qazi, you know Dr. Faisal married to one of the daughters of this masjid, right? Amina. Amina Mirza, who, mashallah, grew up in your masjid. Her husband, Dr. Faisal, is running for city council in Fullerton. We have Sister Farah Khan, who is already a city council member in Irvine, who is running for mayor. We have Ali Taj, who is the mayor, was a mayor, now a city council member in Artesia. We have Ali Saleh, who was the mayor of the city of Bell, now on the city council. I don't know if he went back to being a mayor. They keep rotating. I mean, alhamdulillah, we have a lot running for office nationwide. We have three members of Congress, Ilhan Omar, Rashida Tlaib, Brother Andre Carson. We have a state attorney general, one of the most important states, you know, Attorney General Keith Ellison, former member of Congress now, the one overseeing the whole case you know, the investigation of the murder of George Floyd. So we have Muslims of influence now in politics, and more, dozens and dozens of staffers working at every level, Republicans and Democrats. What I so the outlook is really good, actually. More engagement, more associations, more normalization. There are those who are trying to fight that and push Muslims on the side. They're going to fail. I mean, alhamdulillah, that history is on our side. Time is on our side. We're only getting more entrenched. We're having more friendship, more alliances, more understanding, more confidence. We're deeply rooted now in America. We're not a new history. We're not something on the margin. Alhamdulillah, we are reconnecting with our roots. And I say roots, not just our immigrant roots, but I'm talking about our African-American Muslim roots. What I'm concerned with, and I'll conclude with that, is I want to make sure that we don't get engaged in identity politics, meaning we don't think of ourselves as a race, as Muslims. We are an ummah with a mission, an ummah with a mandate. We're an ummah of goodness. We stand for what is right. We don't want to become just another. We don't want to just cheer for any Muslim who's there, but they stand against our values. Somebody who stands with racism, how am I going to be proud if someone serves with an administration that promotes hate and bigotry and racism? No, I'm not going to celebrate if that person is Muslim because, oh, another achievement. So I hope, inshallah, we keep those checks and balances so we can train those who want to run in the field and become politicians. That also we want you to be true to your Islamic values that stand for, you know, universal value, justice, equality, human dignity. We're not talking about theology. Theology, keep it between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you and your community, you and your masjid, in your personal life. We're not saying bring the theology, who prays, who doesn't pray, who has a beard. Alhamdulillah, this is all great things. We're talking about the universal values that impact mankind in general. And that's where I hope we keep an eye so we don't get diluted. America has a great success in a lot of things. One of them is the dilution or the Americanization of religion, where religion becomes something almost like a, you know, a light, you know, very diet thing. And I hope we manage to find a way where, alhamdulillah, we promote our American Islamic identity. There's nothing wrong with that, but it's something that is rooted in also our values, what brings us together, what brings our love together and our coming to the masjid, our raising of our kids. It is that. That's what brings us together, and I hope we can preserve that, inshallah. And that's why engaging in politics ensures that our rights and our identity is protected. Because if, you know, the people who lose their identity are the ones who are isolated from society. The ones who are marginalized, they end up marginalizing themselves even more. We want to normalize being a Muslim. I want to normalize somebody with a name, Rashida, and Ilhan, and Hussam, and Iraj, and Yahya, and somebody with a beard, and somebody with a hijab, and somebody maybe without hijab. But the point is, we want to make this, you know, what this Muslim diversity is, normal in America.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Brother Ayloush, for today's talk.
Brother Hussam, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
We could do one more question. This could be the last question. Sorry to interrupt.
Inshallah.
Because we have Aisha at 8:30.
Very quick. Brother Hussam, usually we get a guidelines for the proposition every election time, I can't publish it. This time we haven't seen it. If you have already one, can you email it to me so we could pass it out to our community so we can select the wood proposition as a helpful for our community in the future?
Absolutely. I mentioned that early on. Maybe I wasn't clear about it. Alhamdulillah, we finalized it. This year, we're not printing it because there are no Jum'as in the same.
No problem. Just email it to me.
Exactly. We will be sending it early next week. As a link that people can print, they can go online, see it on their smartphone, inshallah. And again, you will get in the mail.
Thank you. And I know you had a very long day today. You did a very inspiring khutbah. Every community likes it. They love to see you, you know. You take your time to come to visit us, okay? And thank you for all your wisdom for the wording, inshallah. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for having me. My pleasure.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inshallah. We thank everybody. May Allah accept from all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our shortcomings. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر جزاكم الله خير السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
Wa alaikum as-salam.
Thank you, brother. Alaikum as-salam.
Alright, guys, we'll be concluding tonight's program. Inshallah, please come next week. And also tell your family and friends about it. And so that we can have more people, inshallah.
Salam.
Thank you, brother.
My pleasure. Thank you, brother, for moderating.
Oh, yeah, no problem.